session on item 15, but it's, we decided that we wanted to have a transparent, open, and fair process, so we will not be going into executive session. We have a number of cards of folks who want to speak on item 15, which is a Whittier issue. And so when we come to public comment, I will call you, and you have 3 minutes to speak. Unless you're representing an organization, you'll have 5 minutes. And I really would appreciate if you keep your comments to 3 minutes and be respectful of the process.
Madam Chair, for you is a timeline, a rough timeline of the litigation, Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy versus the City of Whittier. In June, after the judge's ruling in the primary case, Rory Skay and I sent a memo to the MRCA board as well as the Conservancy and the Advisory Committee, kind of describing the judge's ruling. If you recall, as it relates to the Conservancy's main claim in the case that was heard at the same time, but was actually technically a separate case from the MRCA's case, the judge ruled that the Conservancy was essentially time-barred on their claims under the lawsuit. It was pretty open and shut as it related to the Conservancy. Conservancy's challenge came under Proposition A, a challenge to the conditional use permit issued by the city, and the judge simply found that the lawsuit was not filed in time. The position of the Conservancy as it is now is that oil is obviously fundamentally the issue, but the Conservancy's position was always that the important thing was to enforce the Prop A obligation. That was the nature of the case, and that's the argument the Conservancy made. At the present moment, we've been ordered to, we, the parties in general, the MRCA, the county, Open Space District, and the Conservancy, did I say Conservancy twice, I meant the MRCA, the parties have been ordered to a mandatory settlement conference with another Superior Court judge later this month. That's our position right now. We have nothing further to report. Essentially, we're going to report to the settlement conference as ordered by the judge. I do want to touch on a couple other things. The Conservancy's claim was not a CEQA claim. It wasn't an actual environmental claim. It was a procedural claim under Prop A. There was a CEQA claim filed by the county against the city and the two oil companies. The judge found that the county's CEQA claim was also time barred. The county did prevail on a Prop A argument, a Prop A agreement argument for breach of contract. However, the county's agreement with the city expires in 2 years from this summer. So in 2 years, the agreement will not be in force. The Open Space Legal Defense Fund, which is a nonprofit group formed by citizens, concerned citizens out in the Whittier area, also had a lawsuit against the city and the oil companies that predated the Conservancy, MRC, and the county's lawsuits, and that's outlined in your timeline. After the MRCA and the Conservancy filed their petitions and their complaints, the Open Space Legal Defense Fund did settle with the city and the oil companies. And a portion of the settlement is public because it was with the city, and it calls for Matrix Oil Company to pay for Open Space Legal Defense Fund's attorney's fees. And there were also some limitations on the drillable area and a requirement that a conservation easement be recorded over the remainder property up there. Although it did technically allow the project to move forward. The judge in the case then took the MRCA and Conservancy cases. Later, the county joined as a cross complainant against the city and the oil companies. And after a long back and forth, we had a hearing early June, and that was the subject of the memo that we sent out last month.
So I think it's particularly important that the members of the public understand the situation that we're in. Back in 1994, when George described and others described an extraordinary long hearing of the Conservancy, the practice of the Conservancy was that on many items, in almost all of them, the Conservancy would give instructions to its representative on the MRCA board. That practice was brought to a screeching halt in 2004. You will remember the Department of Finance issued a very critical audit saying that there was not enough institutional separation between the Mounds Recreation and Conservation Authority and the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy. And they directed that pretty much all formal relationships and many, many informal relationships between those two organizations be severed. So no longer do we have recommendations that come from this board to the MRCA board about such things as settlement of litigation. Because the concern was that if the bodies are too closely interrelated, if there is that kind of relationship back and forth, then there are arbitrage issues that have to do with whether there is a sufficient separation between MRCA and MRCA's funding and the state of California. As we know, the MRCA is not a state agency. Its funds, while they're public funds, are not state funds. And this was a requirement of the audit. So we amended the Joint Powers Agreement. Many of you remember all of that. There is now a separation, a very, very strong separation between the two agencies. We cooperate closely together, but there is there's no longer a situation where the Conservancy advises the MRCA or vice versa with respect to litigation. So if people said, well, back then you were all one together in terms of litigation, that was true. That's no longer the case now by operation of law. Secondarily, the issues that we brought all had to do with the enforcement of Proposition A and the restrictions of Proposition A. And it's very important to understand that Proposition A does not prohibit a change in use. What it says, and it's what Section 16B of Proposition A is very clear, says if you do that, you have to repay the amount or the value of the property, whichever is higher, and money derived from that project, if you're changing the use, must be used for purposes of Proposition A. So it's not a blanket prohibition of any development, or really any development that's inconsistent with the contract. You've got to pay it back, and you've got to use the money for Prop A purposes. The city of Whittier proposed, and still proposes, to use the money generated, first of all, not to pay back the MRCA or Conservancy grant. And originally it was a Conservancy grant that we were trying that was our hook. Not to pay that back, to pay the county only the, quote, fair market value of the surface several acres that are involved here, and nothing about the value of the underlying mineral fee. So the clear issue here was, is a general, it's a charter city, is a small, relatively small charter city going to be able to use for purely municipal purposes revenue generated by virtue of a grant that was paid for by everybody in the county. So in Pacific Palisades, we paid for Proposition A. Great Hills pays for Proposition A, Palos Verdes Peninsula pays for Proposition A, but simply by virtue of where the oil is located, Whittier claimed, still claims, the right to use all of that for pure municipal purposes. So, just to give you a kind of a magnitude of what's at stake here, for the Whittier, city of Whittier residents, their general fund is about $65 million a year. And depending on which consultant you believe, that either could be their royalty share or perhaps even larger royalty share that they would have, and perhaps smaller. But it's a huge a huge impact on the city of Whittier's budget. So we now fast forward to this litigation and where everybody was in the litigation. And I think, again, I want to emphasize this. At the time that we filed the litigation, there was this basically local group. What's the name of the
Open Space Legal Defense Fund?
Open Space Legal Defense Fund that had a CEQA lawsuit against the city, made those CEQA claims, and settled them. Settled them for the attorney fees and for some changes in the project. And so it's not a situation, and it's very clear, when they settled their case, we had already filed, all the entities had already filed a case, so it's not a situation where they said, well, we settled because we thought you would carry it forward for us. Our issues were never on the environmental issues, although a lot of people are concerned about that. Our issues were specifically toward where we had legal responsibility, which is to implement Proposition A. So while there's a lot of controversy about whether or not oil should be drilled here, that's not our controversy. I appreciate the fact that there are a number of people here from Whittier. Our suggestion is the place to go on that is back to the city of Whittier and say, this is not something I want you to continue to go ahead and do. And so the Conservancy's legal position now is that we're out of court. The judge said, we're too late, filed it too late, we're out of court. And with respect to the Mountain Recreation and Conservation Authority, that's a separate agency, separate organization. I'm sure the members here will be listening to all the testimony that is made, but that's an issue which is not before you and is not within your purview. What's within your purview is the case that we filed, which was denied. So I hope that that has some juristic value.
Sierra.
Okay, I've got a couple questions, so I'm clear.
Sorry. Are we on item 15 or are we on reports?
We're on reports. Item 15, on my recommendation, we're not going to have a closed session.
So we're discussing a report.
We're having a report on the Whittier litigation and the Conservancy's role in the Whittier litigation. And again, the reason not to have a closed session is so everyone here can be hearing the same things. And so the public can be hearing it. We didn't want to go into closed session, say this, come back out, and people said, well, what happened? What did you say? And we can say, we can't tell you.
And that, he made his, Joe made his comments because we, our next agenda item is members' comments, and all the cards we received are on agenda item 15.